Beautiful, powerful, and life-sustaining. North America's Great Lakes make up the largest freshwater system on the surface of the earth. Of the five Great Lakes, Lake Erie is the shallowest and holds the least amount of water. Yet it is vital to the region's industries, economy, and public health.
The water itself is used for everything from drinking water to irrigating crops, for boating, for fishing, both commercial fishing and sport fishing. And so really any activity that you think of that uses lake water is affected by the quality of that water.
In the 1960s, Lake Erie's water quality was so bad, some people called the lake dead. Then government policies and industrial cleanup efforts greatly restored its health. But since the 1990s, scientists have once again seen a decline in Lake Erie's water quality and a resurging problem with algal blooms. In 2011, toxic blue-green algae covered a sixth of Lake Erie, with the largest toxic bloom ever recorded there, a problem visible from space.
We don't want the Great Lakes to become a cesspool of green scum. We want water that is healthy, enjoyable, and safe.
Tom Bridgeman, a freshwater ecologist at the Lake Erie Center in Toledo, Ohio, is participating in a five-year study funded by the National Science Foundation to evaluate the impacts of climate change, farming practices, and public policy on water quality. Ecologist Anna Michalak leads the team.
And it's only once we understand how that system is working currently that we can really hypothesize about what types of mechanisms, whether it be governance mechanisms or scientific solutions, might actually help with the water quality in the Great Lakes.
Algal blooms are generally caused by an excess amount of nutrients in the water that feeds algal growth, what's called eutrophication. The most common of these nutrients is phosphorus, found in fertilizers. And how are these algae-feeding nutrients getting into Lake Erie? Scientists point to the combination of two primary causes. Farming practices, such as spraying fertilizers on the surface without mixing it into the soil, and changes in rainfall patterns. With a gentle rainfall on fertilized fields, the nutrients are allowed to seep into the soil as food for crops. However, precipitation patterns have changed recently with more intense spring rainfall. These heavy rains create more runoff that washes over the soil surface, taking more fertilizer with it into ditches, streams, and rivers that flow into the lake.
And it's only a matter of hours between when water enters a ditch to when it enters Lake Erie. It's a very quick trip from field to lake.
As part of the study, Bridgeman and his team are collecting water samples at six different locations where water enters Lake Erie's western basin. They filter the water and measure the types and amounts of algae. The water samples are sent to the National Center for Water Quality Research in Tiffin, Ohio, to be analyzed for phosphorus. Water quality specialist Pete Richards, also part of the NSF study, uses the data to understand the complex relationships among precipitation, land use practices, and nutrient runoff to the lake.
To try to deal with only one piece of it can be useful, but it's never going to capture the whole story. So it's something that really has to be done, integrating many different disciplines and understandings.
One solution is something called variable rate technology, which some farmers, like Brett Margraf in McCutcheonville, Ohio, use to apply different amounts of fertilizers in different parts of the field. Using GPS, Margraf locates specific points in his field where he takes soil samples. The samples are tested for nutrients, allowing Margraf to map the fertility of his field and apply only what is needed, where it's needed.
There's a concept called the four R's, which is the right place, the right amount, the right time, and the right method, that sort of encapsulates this idea of trying to be smart about the way we use the nutrients.
To manage the amount of nutrients coming into Lake Erie, scientists, farmers, communities, and policymakers are working together to find solutions for better farming practices and improved water quality on the lake.
The minute that we stop putting fertilizers into the water, it will start to clean itself up. And within a couple years, it would be healthy again. So that's one of the hopeful things about Lake Erie, is that it rebounds very quickly.
Beautiful and irreplaceable, Lake Erie and the entire Great Lakes system are an important natural resource unlike anywhere else on Earth.